Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and Hannah and Jim, thank you for that introduction. It's a real pleasure to actually be able to come and speak this morning, and the reason is I'm not going to go over the case that Andrew talked about for change. I fundamentally believe in that. And today is a real opportunity for us to actually not just talk about the case for change, but start to think about the things we need to do in order to get on with it. And I think we've got a very short window to actually act. Now, I wanted to start and talk about sort of some of my career history. I began work up in Sellafield in the mid-80s. I was talking to somebody just over coffee earlier who was talking about, you know, the industry needs to get its, well, I would say its mojo back, its enthusiasm, its passion. In the 80s at Sellafield, everything was possible. Everything was possible. We had the most fantastic research and development program you can imagine. We were building Thorpe, vitrification plants. I was involved with the 9-acre site, effluent treatment. Some of the most groundbreaking projects anywhere in the world, and they were happening in this country. And as I say, at the time, anything was possible. And it's trying to recreate some of that passion and some of that commitment that we had at the time. It was the most exciting place I have ever worked. And I genuinely mean that. It really was quite a buzzing place. They talk about jumping up in Cumbria, and it was jumping. And as we look forward now, government have got to make some very key decisions about where they're going to get future energy from. Andrew talked about closures. We don't have a right to replace those facilities with new nuclear. We've got to make that case. And when we start looking at some of the other challenges for government, energy efficiency and what's going to happen with battery technology and electrification of transport and all of these issues. You know, when you sit in central government, it's very difficult to start to make some judgments on these industries. And quite frankly, we're not making a good job at the moment of selling ourselves. And we do have the opportunity to do that. The other one I was just going to talk about as well is, Andrew showed some of the other sectors up there, and if you look at the offshore wind, they've actually made a huge case. And if you look at how they've developed as an industry, there's a lot that we need to learn about the attitude and the passion, the commitment, and indeed the leadership of the offshore wind industry and how they've driven that forwards. So I've moved on one, I shouldn't have done that. Just going back to the 80s, when Sellafield was looking to start Thorpe, there was a big program being running at the time called Trust Us. And at the time, the challenge was about transparency of the industry. It was about how much the industry told the public about what it did. There was almost this veil of secrecy about activities. And this whole Trust Us campaign was about the safety, the security, but also the transparency of the industry. I think we've got a different trust challenge today, and I think it relates to, well, I know it relates to cost, but I also think it relates to schedule. And I'm going to major a bit on schedule here, because schedule is the biggest driver of cost in this industry. And people want to know, if they want to invest in these projects, or government want to give go-ahead for nuclear new build, they've got to know that not only can we hit the costs, but the plants can be delivered to the time that they expected. So in my talk, I'm going to cover three things. I want to talk about leadership. I want to talk about collaboration. And I also want to pick up on planning. We don't often talk about planning, but actually planning is so important as a sort of the end product of that leadership and collaboration. So first, let's talk a bit about Cammell Laird. I've got a video of the history of Cammell Laird. Cammell Laird began in 1828. When you're having a cup of coffee at the break, have a look over the water, because the other side of the water, you can see the Cammell Laird shipyard, and I'll show you a picture a bit later, which will orientate you. When you look at this film, it shows a number of the ships being launched that Cammell Laird have built over the years. Now, the health and safety practices in some of these launches, they're certainly not what we would do today, so just bear that in mind. But the other thing I'd like you to look for is the quote at the end, and I'll come back to that. So let's show the film.
Mm-hmm. God guide her, and guard and keep all who sail in her.
The royal launching of this £10 million vessel was undoubtedly one of Merseyside's greatest occasions. Good luck and Godspeed to the new Ark Royal.
This new Union Castle ship is the largest liner built in Britain since the Queen Elizabeth in 1938.
Birkenhead, HMS Conqueror, the fifth of the Navy's planned 8 nuclear submarines, was ready to be launched at the Cammell Laird yard.
The frigate is the most complete warship ever launched in Britain, with its weapons already fitted.
I'll put that quote up there so you can read it. It picks up on some of the things Andrew was talking about earlier. And that was from 2005. The reason it's important is, if you go back to 2001, this is the headline of The Guardian. Cammell Laird went into the hands of the receivers. The bank pulled the credit on the company as a result of a single contract. And it was a contract with a cruise liner company that actually decided not to go ahead with the purchase. And there were a lot of lessons around the business there. But the thing I want you to focus on is that that wasn't the end for Cammell Laird. It could easily have been the end. We could easily have closed down the yard and we could have let that all go. But John didn't. And he and some of his fellow directors decided to keep the company running. They had to set up a new company, so the Cammell Laird brand actually went to the receiver. That was all part of their assets that they seized. And they actually managed to start a new business up. And you can see over there, in 2001, they only had that small area of the yard they were able to actually to get a lease on. And eventually they managed to get the next dry dock over there and continue with activities and start rebuilding the business. And you can see the sort of the timeline on there. Around about 2007, they reacquired the Cammell Laird brand. And 2008, they relaunched the company as Cammell Laird, and it has gone from strength to strength. But what I'm talking there is about leadership. I'm talking about a vision. I'm talking about people who actually have an idea that they share, that they're prepared to commit to, and have the passion to see it through. I need to talk about leadership in our sector, because the sector deal is about to be published in the next few weeks. And like all deals, it has commitments. It has commitments in terms of what government will do to support us, but also what we as a sector are going to do. And our response needs to be really strong. It needs to be really positive. It needs to be a whole sector response as to how we're going to address this. The 20% challenge of cost is not something that Sellafield or the NDA can address on their own. It requires the whole sector to get behind them. The 30% for new build, again, it's not about the developers and how they're going to do it. It's about how we as a sector will actually step up and address those challenges. And we've got to seize that deal. That's our deal. And when Andrew was talking earlier about our industry actually starting to go on a contract, that is exactly what will happen. It won't happen overnight, but once we lose that opportunity, that window to be a part of the new build program, then we will be on that slope of actually sliding out. There'll be lots of decommissioning, there'll be lots of back-end activities, but we'll have missed that window of opportunity for new build. Now, some of the sector deals are a little bit more of the steady as you go. I think Andrew showed that quadrant up there. Ours isn't. It's very much a wake up and smell the coffee deal, and something that we've actually got to have some new innovation, some ideas, because if we don't do things differently, we won't get the different result, the different outcomes that we need. And in terms of today, well, we've got lots of opportunity to talk about some of the things that we can do differently, some of the relationships that we need to forge, and some of the things that we will change going forwards. We don't need more studies, we don't need more reports. There are plenty, and if you don't know where they are, just have a word with me. I can point you to all of the analysis which has been done. My personal view is that we should go after the schedule, because schedule drives costs, and they're the two controlling things that we've got. And if we can control the costs and we can control the schedule, we'll actually be able to deliver the end product in terms of what we need. And that applies to the decommissioning as well as the new build program. But my key message really is around leadership is we've got to grasp this challenge. We've got to take that sector deal and we've got to own it. We've got to own it. And quite frankly, if 30% is the minimum we can do on new build, then I think we should be ashamed of ourselves. I think there's a lot more to go at in that program than 30%. I want to move on now and I want to talk about collaboration. And I'm starting here with two companies that decided to collaborate who you might not have put as natural collaborators. Firstly, an energy drinks company and a company that does digital cameras. But they've had the most fabulous collaboration. And in coming together, actually both of their brands are all about adrenaline-fueled activity. And those of you, I'm sure you all remember Felix jumping out, you know, in that skydive in his Red Bull costume and his head-to-toe in cameras. But that's been the most phenomenal collaboration for these two businesses. They've gone from fairly moderate businesses to huge international brands with massive profiles. And they've done that because they actually saw an opportunity in their separate markets to join forces. And what's really interesting, if you look at the story, and I won't go into too much detail here, but it's actually the innovation that they drove in each other. They were actually able to see different things in each other, and the collaboration generated different results than they would have achieved on their own. This is a small example of collaboration within the sector, but it's one I've been involved in working with the nuclear AMRC. So as Cammell Laird, we've been working with NAMRC, and rather than going to Sheffield and taking a membership there, we've invited them onto our site. And we've got a space, you can see the facility there, where we're actually looking to collaborate. We've got a great workforce, and we've got a great infrastructure, and we've got a great history of shipbuilding, but we haven't got the technology, and we haven't got the in-depth knowledge about qualification in the nuclear industry and supplier development and all of those things. So there's a great opportunity for the nuclear AMRC to bring some of those skills alongside what we can offer as Cammell Laird and enter into this collaboration. And this collaboration needs to extend, and I'll talk about that in a couple of moments. In terms of collaboration, you can see a big center over here, but I wanted to give my definition. And it's three things. The first is about a shared goal. What is it that we want to achieve together? And are we clear on what that is? And if it's all about our individual profit and loss, then that is not a good way to start a collaboration. So the collaboration needs to begin with what is it we're trying to achieve. The second thing is about what are we as individuals or individual companies bring to this collaboration? What are the experiences and skills and contributions we're going to make? But also we need to understand what the other parties are bringing. And we don't want to be overlapped. We want to have complementary skills and complementary capabilities in order to form that collaboration. And the final thing is, collaboration is not about a meeting. It's not about a workshop. It's actually about culture. It's about how we think about our relationships and about how we build those relationships in order to achieve the goal. So collaboration is a way of working. It's a culture. And you need those three things in order to truly collaborate. Just before Before I go on to that, one of the challenges I have for this sector, and the way I see it is that we almost seem to think that competition is within the sector and we're competing with ourselves. We've actually got to make the case for new nuclear and the case for our credibility of decommissioning as a sector before we even think about that competition. If we want to have advanced modular reactors, actually now is not the time to try and choose the winner. Now is the case where we need to make that AMRs are the right thing for the country. An investment in that technology and developing that product is something that the country should entertain. What that technology turns out to be will be something further down the road. But at the moment, as a sector, we need to come together and recognise that this challenge is about how we as a sector perform. And I'm sure competition will happen further downstream. But making that case is something we all need to contribute to. And some of the stuff about learning as well, Hinkley Point or Sellafield or all of these projects, there's things in there that we need to learn. And if you're involved in other new builds or AMRs or other activities, learning those lessons is so important, so important. That brings me on to planning. Now, the slide I've put up here, when I was at Sellafield, I talk about this time when it was absolutely jumping in the mid-80s. But I got an invitation to go and join something called Strategic Management Process, SMP. And I got offered, it was a part-time as part of my role, but they said, look, go and see somebody who knows about strategic planning and he'll tell you all about it. And this is what he told me. And at the time, I honestly didn't understand it. He said, planning is everything, but plans are nothing. Now, I was working on plans day by day. We were following plans. We would schedule our activities. So that's how we controlled the work. But as I've gone on in my career, I actually realize that actually those plans, they don't mean anything. They're just a means of actually reconciling or presenting what you're going to do. The real part about planning is about how people come together. It's about how people can bring together their own ideas, their contributions, and how we understand how all those parts fit together. And without that, plans are nothing. Plans are nothing. The planning process is what creates something which is vital and important. This is a bit of planning that we're, and it's called a module development centre, but we're working through this at the moment. It is not about a module development centre. It's really about planning. It's really about collaboration. It's a collaboration centre around modularisation and working out how we can take something which has been used in automotive, in aero. We build aircraft wings in different parts of the world and assemble them, for that build programme. How do we do that in our nuclear sector? And we have this center, and this isn't just an artist diagram, by the way. This is being built in order to further modularization for the UK nuclear sector. I want to go on and just show you lastly in terms of how it's used in shipbuilding. So this is the Attenborough build at the moment. So this is the ship we're building at the moment. I say, when you look over Coffey, you'll see it the other side. And I want to focus on Block 10, which is at the stern end of the ship. So you'll see that facing you across the water. That block is 950 tons. It was actually built over on the Tyne, and it was floated round through the north of Scotland. That block contains the prop shafts and the drive mechanism for steering the ship. It was designed as a module, it was built as a module, it was shipped round here, and obviously you can see, dimensionally, we had to know that the tolerances were right before we actually put it onto the vessel. But the whole vessel has been designed in a modular fashion so you can build it in parts and assemble it, and importantly, when you assemble it, the whole system performs, the whole thing comes together as a single performing entity. So before I go on to my summary, let's show a video clip of the build of the Attenborough. It's about 12 months of build program there, and you'll see the ship, you'll see the stern facing you, and that's going to be launched in July of this year. It's a 34-month program from the design through to start of sea trials. That's the sort of schedule that we operate for what is a first of a kind, and probably the only one of its kind, the most advanced non-military ship to be built. So just in summary, I've talked about leadership taking control of this sector deal. It's our deal, and we need to, if you like, take ownership of that deal and actually own the delivery of that sector deal. But leadership has an important role then in creating that culture of collaboration. How will we change the behaviours, the mindsets, and the working together of the whole sector in order to start to create that change and be able to assimilate some of the innovations that you're going to see in this auditorium today? But, and this is the most crucial thing, plans are nothing. Planning is everything. If we don't put these innovations into our plans going forwards, they won't happen. They simply won't happen. If we end up with plans that have got some innovation over here, but we'll introduce it when it's proven, believe me, we'll still be looking at that while we struggle to deliver these projects. So the innovations have got to be built into the way we do things. We have to build them in, and we have to understand how those collaborations will work to deliver the end result. Ladies and gentlemen, that's all I've got to say, but thank you very much for your kind attention.